This is Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon. Mitch Lafon.
Welcome to another episode of Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon. Joining me this week from the band The Alarm, it is Mike Peters. They have a new album out coming June 28th called Sigma. Normally, I don't play music, but they gave me permission to play their debut single, or the first single from the album. It is called Blood Red Viral Black, and it features Billy Duffy of The Cult. So there you go. But before that, before we get to Mike Peters, before we get to the song, I have on the phone, co-hosting this week, the one, the only, never duplicated, Ryan Roxie of Alice Cooper's band. Good day. Bonjour, Monsieur Ryan.
What is happening, Mitch Lafon? Always a pleasure to talk to you.
Yes, absolutely. And you're not here just to co-host or just to talk about Mike Peters, but you're here to make an announcement. We are going to, together, have a new show called Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon presents
In the Trenches with Ryan Roxie.
Right. The show In the Trenches, which will be a standalone show. So it'll be here on all my platforms, but it won't include me. Will be Ryan doing what exactly?
Well, you're sort of taking the role of Oz. You're the man behind the curtain on this one, right? You're making dreams happen. And I will be exactly what the title says, in the trenches. I've spent most of my musical career playing it, bashing it out in the clubs, you know, working my way up as much as I could. Got to play with a guy like Alice Cooper, being attached with him for so many years. It's been a great run. And I want to talk to other people that have had similar sort of things happen with them in their careers. So maybe they're not a household name just yet, but they've been working consistently as a musician, making what it is they wanted to do for all these years a reality.
And that's interesting, because a lot of fans don't realize that once you're off the road, sometimes you have to go do other projects. Like, for example, the other day I was on Broadway with Jim Vallance at the Pretty Woman thing, and we went down to where the drum room was, and I said, oh, who's the drummer on this? And he goes, oh, it's Cyndi Lauper's touring drummer. And it's like, what? So, right? And that's really what it's about. When you're not on the road, you're doing these other things. You look at Joel Hoekstra, who's in Whitesnake. When he's not doing that, he's in Cher. When he's not doing that, he's doing Rock of Ages. When he's not doing that, he... And that's sort of what it is to be a working musician.
You know what I call that, Mitch? I call that surviving.
Right.
And making your, you know, basically imagining your reality in one way or another. So, you know, making your dreams, which you've always wanted to do, become realities and maintain and stay realities. So I kind of equate it to the old great white shark theory. You know, for us old school rock and rollers, I think we've got to keep moving. We've got to keep swimming. We've got to keep working. And although we are very happy when those big tours come up, like this summer's tour with Alice Cooper and Hailstorm, that's going to be a blast. We also have to maintain that work ethic, and we got to maintain just that paycheck all throughout the year. And that's what we're doing with a bunch of my solo touring. And that's, like I said, part of this podcast is going to be finding out what goes on in the head of all these working musicians. So I'm excited, really excited to actually talk to all these guys about that stuff, guys and girls.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that too. So tell me something, when you're off the road, have you ever had a period of 6 months, 9 months where you just don't pick up the guitar? And if so, do you sort of lose some chops and got to sort of retrain to get back into it?
I think every musician, when they're in an interview style, always says, oh no, I never step away from this. I'm practicing all the time. I'm practicing when I sleep. But there, I'll be honest with you, there are times, there are some weeks that I go by when I'm doing other stuff. I get caught up in something, maybe it's still music related, but I'm not playing my instrument as much as I feel I should be. So I do have to remind myself, like, hey, at the end of the day, you're a guitarist, so you keep your chops up, you keep your motor skills up. And that's what I'm finding doing a lot of these interviews and talks with these men and women, that, you know, they are dedicated to their instruments and dedicated also to their craft, but also dedicated to their careers.
Yeah, they really are. So quickly tell me about some of the guests that you have already approached and already interviewed, And then how are we rolling this out? So this is something that is going to start in July, right?
Yes. Yes. I want to try and coincide the release of In the Trenches with Ryan Roxie right around the time that Alice Cooper and Hailstorm start their tour. So look for it around that time. Check out the tour dates, and then we'll get a weekly schedule going. We'll play it by ear for the first couple of releases, but you know, already I've been stockpiling these interviews with some very special people. And I just had a great talk last week with Phil X of the Bon Jovi band, and also Charlie Starr of Blackberry Smoke. So these are like some hardcore names and heavy hitters that are coming to the table and really sharing some cool stories, some really good advice. And I think we're able to relate to each other in such a way because we've been on a lot of the same stages. And we've been, I guess, for lack of a better word, we've all been in the trenches for so many years.
And I also know you've done Steve Brown, who, of course, is doing stuff with sometimes Def Leppard. But Def Leppard also has a band called Tokyo Motor Fist, which features Chuck Berge from Billy Joel's band. And it's just, and that again goes to show.
And that will lead into another interview that I'm supposed to
set up with Chuck.
With Chuck. Yeah.
Yeah.
And like I said, Steve Brown, we've known each other for years and we were finally able to do something in a interview type of style, but I mean, it was a long form podcast format. And I'm glad we had that long form because he had so much good information, especially for up-and-coming guitar players and up-and-coming musicians that are doing their best to make it in this world right now.
Yeah, and he really sort of exemplifies what In the Trenches is all about, because he steps in for Dennis DeYoung, he steps in for Def Leppard, he does the Trickster thing, he does Eric Martin's band, he does Tokyo Motor. Like, he really is a working man's working man in terms of musicians. And it's just, it goes to show, people think, well, Chuck is in Billy Joel's band, he's got nothing else to do. No, he still goes out and he does.
But it's all anchored in the fact, and you'll see this if you watch the interview. If you listen to it, that's fine too. But it's all anchored in the fact that we recorded it from his studio, his recording studio that he's recorded all his albums since the early days, and it all came from Trickster money. So no matter what's happened, you know, up until right now, it's all based on the fact that he was smart with his money, with his first successful, really successful band, which was Trickster. And he's just been able to keep it building and keep it rolling.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah, that's great stuff. And should we get over to Mike Peters and the Alarm? Are you an Alarm fan, by the way?
Absolutely. Tony Visconti, the producer of the Electric Angels album, which was my very first album I ever made. The album that he had produced right before we went into the studio with Electric Angels was The Alarm. So there you go.
Oh, wow. And of course, Electric Angels, one of the greatest debut albums. Folks, if you haven't checked it out, you've got to check it out. But just real quick.
When you say to Mike Peters, please, please tell him love, hope, and strength.
Yes, absolutely. Right, and of course, that's his charity, as you know. He has had non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, he's had leukemia, his wife had breast cancer. They have gone through incredible struggles, and you will hear all about that during the interview. But before we get to the interview, for the first time on Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon, we are going to play a song. It is Blood Red Viral Black. It is the new Alarm single. The album drops on June 28th, so enjoy the song. We'll be right back. Now that is a rock song, folks. Absolutely terrific. And keep in mind as you're listening to the podcast that it does go through a podcast filter before it goes up. So if you really, really want to enjoy the song the way it's supposed to, head over to YouTube or Spotify and find the single there and get the full sort of dynamic range. But you get the idea. Now, I will get over to Mike Peters in a second, but I want to say this about Mike. We had been set up on a conference call to do the interview, and we got in about 5 or 6 minutes in, and the line dropped, and then Mike phoned back, and we started again, and the line dropped, and I finally said to him, hey, listen, just give me the number where you're at. I will phone you directly. And so we did that. I phoned him directly and we redid the entire interview from the beginning. So it turned out absolutely fantastic. But what I'm going to do here is at the end of the show, when we say goodbye, I am going to tack on the original interview on the conference call that lasted, I think it was 6 minutes or 7 minutes, but anyway. But you will notice, by the way, that when I phoned him direct, we had a nice clear line and everything was gorgeous. And when we did it on the conference call, it just, that's the only way I can describe it. But listen, today you're getting all kinds of bonuses. You're getting Ryan Roxie of Alice Cooper's band announcing a new show. You are getting music on the podcast, which I normally do not do, mostly because of rights management and all that stuff. So, but we had permission. You are getting one full entire terrific Mike Peters interview, and then you're getting a bonus 6 or 7 minutes of another Mike Peters interview that was supposed to be the interview, but because the conference line that we were put on was awful and cut out on us not once, but twice, and rather than throw up our arms and go, "Ah!" we just said, hey, let's skip to that. Let's get over to Mike Peters' new album, Sigma, on June 28th. Buy it once, buy it twice, make everybody happy. Here is the one, the only, Mike Peters.
Yeah, great to be on the show with you. We're really looking forward to a new adventure with the Sigma album coming out on June the 28th. And we put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into it, and we can't wait to share it with all our fans.
It'll be spectacular, and it's a good thing that it comes out on that day, because on June 28th, it'll be my 17th anniversary with my wife. But talk to me about...
Congratulations.
Thank you. Last year, you put out the album Equals. This year, you have Sigma. It harkens back to the old days of Sabbath and Kiss and all those bands that every 6 months to a year had a new album. Talk to me about sort of having albums out, you know, back to back, 1 year after the other.
Yeah, originally the material that both Equals and Sigma draw from was created from a period of time where there was a lot of alarm historical anniversaries arrived, and I knew that everyone would want to look back at those records, and we remade a version of Declaration as a modern record in 2014, and when it was the Strength anniversary in 2015, we remade that record as well, and took those songs and put them in modern context, and it allowed me to sort of check back into some of the original influences of the Alarm, but then take them forward, and that started to create a situation where a lot of new material was written, and I had a massive pool of songs. And originally I was thinking that I'd make a double album that was going to be called Blood Red Viral Black, and that's how it was first conceived. But from talking with fans and with talking with people that I knew and respected who have an eye on what I'm trying to do and achieve as an artist, I just felt that probably the times for double albums aren't quite in this time frame. So I decided to just press on and we released the first set of songs as Equals, but we knew we were going to come. Oh, we got cut off, have we?
No, we're still here.
But I think there must be 10 trying to get hold of us as well. So my phones ringing from all sides here.
Yeah. Now, folks, for folks who are listening, we tried the interview before and we got cut off. So this is sort of a redo, right? And sometimes in life you get a redo. Most times you don't. But
it's good to have a redo sometimes, because that's what really where this creative path to these records started, by remaking our original history, and then all the material just felt like it was better served coming out in two stages, an album called Equals last year, and then a year to the day we'd have Sigma. But the two albums are related. The Equals kicks off with a big banging tune called Two Rivers, which finishes a lot of the Alarm gigs these days. It's a real big anthem with our fans. But the Sigma album that comes out on June the 28th closes with a very different version of that song, with a different lyric that sort of addresses its opposite feel, if you like. It's about where the two rivers meet, where the opposites come together in life and create an allegiance. And so I want to show both sides of the tale and how things flow into each other and become good. So when you get to the end of Sigma, you're really back at the beginning of Equals and vice versa. So they're very much linked, and we're really looking forward to playing all the songs live on the tour this summer.
Yeah, I can't wait. And of course, the album includes Billy Duffy from The Cult. And my interview just yesterday was Billy Duffy from The Cult. And he was talking about you in loving terms, for the lack of a better word. Talk to me about having, he loves you, and we'll quickly talk about the Color Sound project as well, but
yeah,
talk to me about having him on the Blood Red Viral track, Blood Red Viral Black track. That is one hell of a tongue twister right there.
It is. Well, Billy came, you know, we've been friends since the mid-90s, and we met when both the Alarm and the Cult were in periods of transition and hiatus, really, and were dormant at that time, and we struck up a great friendship. I think we both gained a lot of clarity on our positions in our bands through talking to each other as friends and opposites, but we were connected because we went and we didn't have an agenda with each other. I wasn't in his band and he wasn't in mine, and I think we got a perspectives on I think Ian Asprey became a little bit clearer to Billy through talking to me, and in the same way the Alarm guys became more tolerant of some of their excesses through talking to Billy, because I realized how they approached, how a guitarist would approach being in a band, and we became really deep friends through that, and we love walking in the mountains together. In fact, we'll be hanging out in about a week's time doing the same thing, I'm sure. And our friendship has continued, and we started a band called ColourSound, like you mentioned, and it was a real fire in that group. There was something really exciting going on. We had a big buzz in the industry, and we played a big show in London that was absolutely sold out. You couldn't get in. And Ian Asprey was at the gig. Ian from The Cult and Eddie McDonald from The Alarm were there, and almost the next day the phones were ringing. Let's put The Cult together and let's go and play at Woodstock. And then Eddie was on the phone with me, and the Alarm went off and toured with Big Country in 1999. And through ColourSound, we both ended up in the bands that are part of our destiny in life. So a lot of good things happened. But I think we both feel that there was unfinished business with ColourSound, that we had the potential to form a really incredible band that was the sum of The Cult and The Alarm, and maybe something else that was a certain chemistry about a relationship that you can hear on the track Blood Red Viral Black on our Sigma album. Billy, it was Christmas time. Billy came to the studio to hang out, and next minute he's got a guitar and he's ripping through the music in only the way that Billy can. And we've got a strong bond. You know, James Stevenson, our guitarist in The Alarm, has played in The Cult on and off for many years. And in fact, that's sort of how I got to know James, is through Billy Duffy, when I needed a new guitarist for The Alarm. I met James through Billy. So we're so deeply entrenched in each other's lives and culture that it's hard to see the join sometimes.
Yeah, and Billy sort of felt that he left you a little high and dry when The Cult came calling for him. Did you get a sense that he sort of just ran off and rejoined The Cult, or were you sort of always expecting it?
I think it was just that the first call came in was to do the cult for me and Astri. And if it had been the other way around, it'd been the guys in the alarm, it might be me saying I left Billy high and dry. I think that's just how life played it out. But when I met Billy, whenever I was we were playing in ColourSound and we were getting excited, I would always say to Billy, look, you're going to be back in the cult very soon. That, you know, you belong in the cult. That's your life. That's your trademark. That's who you are, your identity. You'll never be able to erase that. No matter how good ColourSound became, we would always have to play Seashell Sanctuary at the end of the set, no matter what. Or we'd have to do Strength by the Alarm if it was, the shoe was on the other foot. So I was really happy for Billy when the cult call was made. I was disappointed that we didn't get to follow through on ColourSound, because we made some demos that became an album, but there was so much more there when we were playing live. If we could have taken those songs into a studio and made a real record, it could have been something else, and we might not have had to look back at the bands we're now in again. So who knows? But that's the way the cards were dealt. I've always accepted that's how life plays out, and I don't have regrets in life. So I'm just thrilled that Billy's back where he belongs, back in the cult. And whenever I go and see him play, he looks so happy, and he plays. You know, his playing is so suited to the cult. It's uncanny. It's untrue.
That's true. And I saw them live last week. It was spectacular. And who knows? You know, it's not the same environment as it was back then. There's no reason why you two can't get together and make a second one or another project, because, you know, it's not a question of competition anymore or,
you know, nowadays we have the internet, and we can relate the scale of our ideas. You know, I think in the 80s, maybe even possibly in the 90s, if you did a project outside of your main band, it was seen as being a solo record, was seen as being, oh, the group's splitting up, or the greatest hits release was always going to be, oh, they've dried up, there's no more new music. But now with the internet, you can talk direct to your fans without going through the third party journalism that existed and dominated our worlds in the 80s. You've got a real straight voice to your audience, and you can say, oh, I'm doing a soundtrack for a play this week. It's coming out, but it's not the next album to be judged on. This is just an interlude in the footpath of our career. Yeah. And I think you can easily communicate those things really well now.
Yeah, you really can. So let me get back to the Alarm. The tour starts July 17th in Nashville, Tennessee, runs all the way to August 15th in Milwaukee. No Canadian dates.
It's even going to run even longer than that now. It's going up to September the 8th in St. Petersburg, so we've added a lot more dates.
There you go. I wasn't sent those ones.
Oh, a lot of dynamic things happening as a result of this tour, so we just keep adding things and making life up as we go along.
Tour dates I have in front of me didn't have that, but I do see that, there is Boston and stuff, but still no Canada. So we'll have to do something about that. But more importantly,
we will most definitely, because we came to Canada on the Equals tour, and we played up in Vancouver, and we also played in Toronto, and we had an amazing show in Toronto. It was absolutely fantastic. And, you know, the Alarm have always had a good relationship with Canada. We came in 1987 and in the winter and did a lot of dates right through Canada. And we've got a special relationship with Canadian people who've come over the border to see us or travel to Wales to come to our gatherings. And we always look forward to seeing them. And Canada is a special place, and we can't wait to get back there.
Yeah, I can't wait to have you here now. But I was going to say also, there's going to be a bone marrow donor registration drive at the shows. Do I want to say struggles? Is that the proper word? But you've had, of course, medical issues with cancer. Your wife has had that. Talk to me about the importance of having these bone marrow donor drives at the shows and what it means to you, not only as a band, but on a personal level, given what you've had to go through.
Well, doing the donor drives at concerts in the United States, obviously Canada's very well served with a bone marrow registry, but less so in other parts of the world. And for me personally, to get people on the registry who can help save the lives of cancer patients like myself who have leukemia, blood cancers, to give them a chance to have that transplant, to stay alive for their children, or to get that second opportunity at life, it's really important to me. And And to be able to turn our concerts into life-saving events through having bone marrow donation booths at the shows, it just adds an extra dimension to what we're trying to do when we're on stage and communicating with our fans, and we're trying to uplift them, make them feel good to be alive. And if we can actually create a process where they can do a cheek swab, get, sign up some forms so we can follow them through life, and they can get called to save someone else's life, well, it's the ultimate rock and roll ambition, isn't it? If you can play a gig and it saves somebody's life. Last night, a DJ saved my life is the song. But, you know, we've done a lot of rock and roll shows where the band has helped and the fans have helped save someone's life. And that's the ultimate goal of all rock and roll, as far as I'm concerned.
It really is. And I would argue that music itself is very medicinal, in the sense that a lot of people have gone through hard times, and you put on that favorite track, whether it's Strength or whether it's Rock and Roll All Night or whether it's Black Dog, and you go, yeah, you know what?
Absolutely.
It
saved my sanity thousands of times when you're being challenged by life and you have to walk away from something, and you get in the car and bang the stereo out, and then a song comes on that you're not expecting, and you think, and the lyrics speak to you, and it helps you through. It helps you find some clarity. You know, we live in a very muddy world now. There's a lot of conflicting emotions, thoughts, and ambition being put out there, and that are clashing and colliding all day long on our news channels. And then sometimes you put a bit of music on, and there's a lyric there that just cuts straight to the moment for you and cuts through it all and shines a little window on your life that allows you to see things clearly and move forward. And that, you know, music has always been that friend to me.
So let me ask you, how do you see things clearly and move forward when in your family, your marriage, there's been non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, breast cancer? How do you focus and are able to move forward? How do you not just sort of give up and become exceptionally depressed and just say the hell with it? No, because it's a remarkable story. If you threw that at me and my wife, I'd be like, okay, I'm out. I'm done. It's too much. But not only do you you create Love, Hope, Strength. Lovehopestrength.org, by the way, if folks want to check it out.
It's just an instinct. My wife Jules and myself, we brought up by quite strong families, very together families, and we've always been brought up to face adversity with see it as an opportunity, really, to rethink what you're doing. You know, the first alarm single was Unsafe Building. It was all about rebuild your life, rebuild your home, rethink your values, rethink yourself right through. And that's never stopped for me. We're here for some sort of purpose. Again, we sung in our first single, we're here for a purpose, but we'll have to search for it. And so these things are sent to us to help us find out who we really are, I think. And so I've always had quite broad shoulders and can take a lot on them. Just luckily I've got, you know, really great bandmates, great fans. You know, we've built up some incredible friendships and deep relationships with our audiences over the years. And that's allowed us to, and given us a reason to want to come back. You know, we've got a loyal audience who want to hear our new music. They want to hear us celebrate the past as well. They want us to live, to make the next concert happen. And they've helped me as much as we've helped ourselves. And it's a communal thing. And being in hospital as much as I have been in most of my adult life, I've seen some incredible and inspiring events happen that have been channeled into me, keep me going. And my wife happening too. And we're really grateful to be alive, which is, we take every day that comes, which is all the cliches that people have when they have these miracle recoveries and survive incredible ordeals. And we just try to pass that on to our audience. I think we're lucky to have gone through these moments together, not just alone. You know, there's a lot of people have to face cancer alone and they don't have a family around them. And that's why our charity is called Love, Hope, Strength, because that's the most, the medicines are great and the treatments are incredible and the procedures are advanced beyond our imagination now, and people have a fighting chance. But you also have to have love, hope and strength to get through these things, to come out intact as a human being on the other side. And so I felt this is our opportunity to tell our good news story. Jules and I have got good news to tell. We've survived our ordeals. You know, my treatment is oral now. I used to be in hospital, wired up to a machine every 3 weeks. That's why I could never tour. I had to have hardcore treatment all the time. And now, I'm because of advances in science, I take what was originally called an oral chemotherapy treatment. Now, somewhere along the line, this treatment has morphed into it's now an anti-cancer treatment. That's what it says on the bottle. It doesn't say oral chemotherapy anymore. It says anti-cancer treatment. And I think that's an incredible statement and shows that there's hope for all of us out there, because cancer affects us all, whether we like it or not. But it is on the run. And that's a good news story. And we that's the fuel that is poured on our fire every night when the alarm takes the stage.
Yeah, you're right. And cancer does affect everyone. My wife lost her father in 2013 to prostate cancer, and it was devastating. They told us like December 4th, and by Christmas it was that fast. But let me bring it back to the music and performance. You know, you're doing these things at the shows, but for you as an artist, because I know as all of us get older, the neck and the knees and the back and now you've had all these treatments. How do you get out there and do a 75-minute show and a 90-minute show? Is it a struggle, or does the yeah?
No, it's not. Look, music keeps us all going. You know, it's what we live for, and you know, as long as I can play and strum and sing, I'll find a way to get on the stage. I'm like that guy in Monty Python, you know, in King Arthur. You know, they keep chopping his legs, and he goes, "It's a mere flesh wound," and he keeps going. And I'm like that guy, you know, just keep rocking away. And I do a lot of training. You know, I work hard to hang on to my youth. You know, I'm 60 now, but I still feel like a young guy, and I've got a lot to contribute and a lot to give back. You know, I think we're from a generation now where there's no real gap between us and our kids. And I get in the car and I listen to the same music my boys listen to, and I turn them onto stuff, and they turn me onto things, and we just keep having this great sharing life together. And I think that makes you feel young, keeps you young as well, and keeps us all going. And you know, who knows where life's going to take us, but I'm ready for whatever's coming next.
There's so much coming next. Now, for maybe American audiences, they might not be aware of what the MBE is, but it's the Member of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire. You were awarded that by His Royal Highness Prince Charles. Talk to me about getting that, because there is a sense that when you're in rock and roll, you're sort of anti-establishment. But at the same time, when you get an award like that, it actually is kind of nice, right?
Yeah. Well, I think for our award, it was for all the people that was support, love, hope, strength, and it was. You know, I've met Prince Charles a couple of times, and he's a rock and roll guy. I sang for the 75th anniversary celebrations of the National Health Service, and I was singing a song, and I was a bit nervous because he was sat right in front of me, and when I got introduced to him after the show, he was very intrigued by my guitars, and he'd been tapping his foot all along, and he loved the song, and he was cool. He put you at your ease. But you know, I was awarded the honor because of all the work that the Alarm fans are putting in to support Love, Hope, Strength, and all the work we've done to help build cancer centers around the world with the help of people like Billy Duffy and other great artists out there in the world that support what we do, from, you know, Frank Turner to Kenny Chesney. You know, it's right across the board, and we're very lucky to get garnered all that support. And the MBE is recognition, not just for me and Mike Peters and the Alarm and my family. It's for all of us who are connected to the Love, Hope, Strength Foundation.
A great foundation. Going back historically, when you decided to very publicly leave the Alarm, Talk to me about what was going through your head at the time. Was it just a great sense of desperation and you didn't know where to turn next? Or was it about making a statement? And do you sort of look back now and say, maybe I could have handled that just a little bit better?
Yeah, it was. Look, it was definitely out of character for me to make that statement on the stage. But at the same time, you know, in the context of the era, whenever we released a statement, you were communicating with your fans through third parties, and they would always, if you said, "Oh, we've got a tour coming up," they'd say, you know, a wake up call, here's the alarm, or put something horrible about us, you know, big hair rock band, the alarm, or something. And I thought, you know, the alarm was a band that was built with the fans in mind, and they were as much a part of the group as I was. And I felt that by speaking from the stage, it would be recorded by the cameras that were there, and people could see the emotion and the intent behind what had driven me to that particular point in life. And I never saw it as really leaving the alarm. I thought it was going away rather than leaving. And that would have been the case if we'd been allowed to have the meeting we wanted to have the next morning, but that was cancelled. But life brings you full circle. You know, I've just spent the week recording with Dave, our original guitarist. He plays on the Sigma album on the song Equals, and we've Nigel Twist, our old drummer, came up on stage with us, and we've been supporting Eddie and his new band, Small Town Glory. So we're like one big family, really. You know, we break up sometimes, we get back together, we celebrate. You know, we live for each other, we live through each other. We'll always, once you're part of it, you'll always be a part of it, and that's how it is with the alarm. You might go away, but you never truly leave. And to come home, you have to go away. So I'm back home where I belong in the alarm now. We're making the music for the future. We celebrate where we come from. And life's good, you know. And I wouldn't have it any other way. You know, we are made because of what life throws our way and what we do to each other. Sometimes, you know, you have to be able to inflict truth upon each other. Sometimes you know love is not always about being kind. Sometimes you have to be honest with people, even if they don't want to hear that honesty. If you truly love them, that's how you have to be. And I think that your actions you'll always be judged on your actions at the end of the day. And I'm not at the end of the day for the alarm, but you know, I always want it. When we were came out in 1983, people said we were this, we were that, and I thought, well, we're none of those things. You'll find out when we've lived the life we're destined to live, and we're living that life now. And yeah, we might be coming to the final chapters of the Alarm story of this generation of people who made the music under the banner the Alarm, but because of our age. But I think, you know, we've got a great legacy that everyone who's been in the Alarm could be really proud of. Every fan who's come to a concert can be really proud that this band they signed up to, bought into when they heard our records and played on the radio, or saw us supporting U2 or Stiff Little Fingers. We're still the same band. You know, the faces might have changed. The sound of the group might have changed, but the ideal behind it is still intact and pushing us forward towards tomorrow.
Yeah, towards tomorrow. And let me just quickly go here to the album Strength. You did, of course, have the 1985-86 remaster that came out earlier this year. How important was that album, not just for the band, but also for breaking the North American market? Because I know Declaration came out before, but from my perspective in Canada, Much Music really sort of came on board when Strength came out and when those songs hit. Is that the one that sort of helped break you here, or was Canada just a little bit behind the curve?
No, Canada was always really kind to the Alarm, and I think we just at the point of at that time in 85, the Alarm were in step with all our peers, you know, with In Excess, with Simple Minds, with the Waterboys, with Big Country, with U2. You know, we were all striding forward and not far behind. None of us were that far ahead or that far behind. You know, REM were in the mix as well. But after the Strength album, when we came back to the UK, we had a difficult time as the Alarm. We had a year where the band didn't want to record the songs that myself and Eddie McDonald were putting forward. It was all about trying to write group compositions or work in a completely different way that was alien to the way the group was built. And we lost our momentum. When we came out with the follow-up album with Eye of the Hurricane, we came in the wake of all those other groups. You know, U2 had released Joshua Tree and In Excess and released Kick, and they became global entities. And we went on a label that could compete in that way. We went on the majors. We were on a small label called IRS, just like REM were until they left to go to Warner Brothers. But at the time in 85, the momentum of our generation was at its peak. And it didn't matter what label you were on at that point in history, your music carried you. And then certain politics kicked in. You know, the idea of MTV and Much Music started to become less innocent, and it became more about how much money you were spending on your videos to get on the playlist. You know, when we first arrived in 83, there was hardly any videos. You know, we made the Stand video. It was a one take shot for a TV thing in LA, and it became our video with a poppy paint spray. It cost nothing to make, and it got seen all over the world. It was huge. But and then come 85, 86, 87, all of a sudden MTV won't play videos unless you'd spent $100,000 or something on the budget. They only wanted big budget screens because they were worried about the look of the show and not the content of the music. It became about the video, not the song. And that's why, you know, 85 put us at a peak.
Well, 85
I'm going to have to sign off here because I've got another interview.
Yes.
To do, I'm afraid.
So I'll just remind folks, Sigma is out June 28th. Mike, an absolute pleasure. And fans, stick around. I will play the first part of the interview before. Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
You're listening to Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon. Rock Talk.
Okay, Mike, I have Mitch on the line.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Mike. Pleasure to speak with you.
Nice to speak to you, too. How you doing?
Good. Good. We've got about 20 to 25 minutes. We'll talk about the album, and let me just get started here. On 3, 2,
okay.
1. We are speaking with Mike Peters of The Alarm. The new album is Sigma. Mike, an absolute pleasure to talk to you.
Well, great to be on the show. Thanks for having me.
Yes, and you were, in fact, a great part of the conversation I had with yesterday's guest on the show, who happens to, of course, be Billy Duffy of The Cult. We were talking about the ColourSound album and your friendship, so we will get into all of that, but let's talk about this new album. For a few years, you hadn't put anything out, and then you came up with Equals, and then you came up with this one a year later. Talk to me about sort of getting back into the swing of things and getting an album done sort of in this one-year space.
Yeah, well, it was conceived from a lot of material. We've been honouring a certain amount of Alarm historical dates with 30th anniversaries of some of our major milestone records, and there just didn't seem the space for new material. And in that time period, I mashed a lot of songs, and more than a double album's worth, really. And so that was the original intention, was to make a double album, and it was going to be called Blood Red Viral Black. And I did a lot of demos, and recorded a lot of material. And I just thought that the time for a double album is probably not right now, so we just decided to release the album in two capsules, what, a year apart, really. But they're both related to each other. The album from 2018 called Equals, and it started with a big banging song called Two Rivers, and Sigma, a year and a day later, closes with the same song, but with a different set of lyrics and a totally different feel, and it sort of marries and bookends and brings the whole project together as one.
So talk to me about the importance of a band like The Alarm making new music, because Declaration had its 35th anniversary. In March, you put out that deluxe edition of Strength. You could technically just go out and tour those albums and play all the hits, and all the fans would love you for it. What sort of inspires you to put together a new collection of songs and sort of go through the whole process of booking studio time and writing and rewriting and getting a producer and just...
Well, it's really important that the lifeblood to the band is in its creativity. It always has been, always will be. You know, we're a band that even when we look back at our history, we look at it creatively. When the 30th anniversaries of Declaration and Strength came along, we actually re-recorded the albums in a modern context. And I do try to view the songs as I'd written them today, because I still play them. Like you say, they're still very valid songs. They have a big connection with our audience and with new audiences who come into contact with those songs through films like 13 Reasons Why and Narcos and all these kind of new programs, Stranger Things, that are out there that are playing, considering playing the Alarms music in their soundtrack. So, but to survive and be around to be able to play today, we have to have new music. That's what keeps us sane, keeps us interested, keeps our audience awake. And I think it's really important. And of course, when we go out on the road this summer, we'll be playing all the songs people know us for, alongside the songs from Equals and Sigma that are relevant to the context we find ourselves each night on the tour. And I think having new songs refreshes the old songs, and then the old songs get set in a new context by standing alongside new songs as well and new content. So I think it all helps each other, everything, to stay fresh and alive.
It really does. In fact, you mentioned a couple of TV shows there. So let me ask you about that. How important is a company like Netflix to a band like The Alarm? Is that sort of one of the new ways to monetize the music, considering that the music industry is not what it was in the 80s?
Well, look, say a song like The Alarm's single from 1983, which is The Stand. That was the first record we ever released in the US of A. And that song had been dormant for a long time. You know, it's a long way back to 1983. And then it featured in the final scene, or a very powerful scene, of 13 Reasons Why on Netflix. And we woke up the next morning and there was a million and a half listeners tuning into The Alarm on our Spotify page that weren't there the day before. So obviously we have to view that as being a great way of communicating, because I'm still proud of The Stand. I think it's still very relevant, and to see it making a connection with young people through a television series is why we made the record, and we still stand by it today. We know it can stand up in the modern times. It's just that it gets defined as coming and almost time stamped by being coming from the 80s, but really it's still as relevant as it ever was. And when it's set in these new contexts, as defined by these new types of box set, binge watch television series, and Alarm song pops in there, it can sound really fresh. And those people who are listening, they're not influenced by a journalist or a playlist. They just think, wow, what's that? Shazam, let's find out who this band is. And bang, it all leads them back to The Alarm. They find our website if they want to go deeper, and then they find our tour dates, and all of a sudden, our original bands are rubbing shoulders with a new generation of audience that are coming in through the door. So it helps everybody.
It really does, and it's great because they're also not influenced by fashion or by a look or, oh, that's my dad's music. It's terrific. So let me quickly talk about Billy Duffy, because during my interview with him, he was exceptionally, I guess, kind to you. He loves you. Talk to me about that relationship. You know, the cult broke up at some point in the 90s. He comes over and you two get this ColourSound project put together. And during my interview, he sort of had remorse that he went back to the cult and he sort of left you hanging. Do you feel that way too? Was it a project that was left?
I think both Billy and I started something. We lit a fire with ColourSound that we never got to really fan the flames as much as they could have possibly burned as brightly as they possibly could. I mean, when I met Billy, I had to sort of say, look, you will always be Billy Duffy of the cult. You'll never get away from that, just as I'll always be Mike Eaton of the Alarm. And at the time, both our bands were on hiatus and were defunct at the time, in a way. And I think we walked in the mountains a lot. And I think for Billy, it was great for me to have a sounding board with it.
And that was it, folks. That's how it ended. Just Bye. Anyway, thank you for listening. Thank you for checking out the show. Please follow me on Twitter at Mitch Lafon, Instagram at underscore Mitch Lafon. I do have a YouTube page as well. And head over to loudtracks.com/Mitch. loudtracks.com/Mitch. And pick up some Mitch merch.
This is Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon. Mitch Lafon.